Good evening, virtual world. Happy Earth Day. Welcome to another episode of the Koch Korner, which is part of the Farmer's Alley at Home series, where I interview artists and theater makers and community leaders from Kalamazoo and all across the country who are dedicated to enriching the theater while also creating opportunity for equity and access to all who love this art form. Oh, it's been pretty tumultuous recently. So I have a guest who just exudes warmth and positivity and love and beauty all at the same time. I dare you to not smile tonight while I talk to this magnificent creature. Her name is Cassandra Blair, and I'm just thrilled to have her here, and we're going to talk about lots of stuff. I'm going to tell you a little bit about her, and I want to bring her on because she is sure to brighten your evening or day if you happen to be watching this on a replay. Cassandra Blair is an actress, singer, writer, and producer from Southwest Michigan, and she has her roots in live theater. After moving to LA, she recently has garnered several TV credits, including Westworld, SWAT, Stumptown, 911, and a new HBO pilot starring Jean Smart. Cassandra is also a writer and producer. She launched her film and production company, which is called Dive Bomb Productions, in 2017, in honor of her mother. And that's interesting because we're going to be talking about Mother's Day. And produced her first film, Shot of Whiskey, which is set to release soon. She graduated from Western Michigan University for her undergrad. She played the role of Cassandra in the Farmer's Alley production of Vanya, Sonia, and Masha and Spike. And she is featured in the upcoming Farmer's Alley virtual concert event celebrating Mother's Day, which is called Songs in the Key of Mom. Please welcome Cassandra Blair.
Hi.
Hey.
Good introduction.
Thank you.
I feel like I paid you to say all of that.
Nope, I promise. I actually just made all that up.
Man, that's good.
But I meant it. I'm telling you. I know I'm getting ahead of myself here, but you know, Cassandra, you're one of the performers that we're featuring in that Mother's Day special called Songs in the Key of Mom. And when I watched your video, I just got so emotional. It was all the things I mentioned earlier. It was positive and warm and filled with love and talent and fierceness and all of those things all at the same time. And, you know, it's been, like I said, it's been rough, right? I mean, for many people, for many reasons, but, you know, specifically in the Black community with the Chauvin trial and all of that. And so just watching you and just seeing you, I can't wait for people to see it themselves. And there's going to be a sneak peek, everybody. So you're going to get a little peek, but then you're going to want to buy a ticket and see the whole darn song.
Invited. So thank you.
Thank you. Thank you for being here. So let's just jump in. And why don't we go back a little bit to the beginning? You know, tell us a little bit about how you got involved in the arts to begin with.
Yeah, of course. I mean, you ask anybody in my family, and I was a drama queen, like, from the start. So, you know, I didn't just say, ow, I went, oh, you know, the whole fall on the floor, cry, like that. Apparently, it was in my blood. I don't know. So I remember, you know, I first, in terms of, like, performing in front of a crowd, that was in church, you know, like a lot of especially Black artists, we get our start singing in the church choir. So that was when somebody first, you know, told me that I was any good, that I had any level of talent. And it wasn't just me singing into my hairbrush, into a mirror, pretending to be, I don't know, Paul Abdul or maybe whoever it was at the time. I'm aging myself probably.
We've all done that.
So church was the beginning. And then I found opportunities to express myself through art in school, like, you know, that kind of fostered it. I had a middle school choir teacher, which everybody knows, Mrs. McNeil. If you grew up in Kalamazoo, you know, Millwood Middle.
Millwood Middle.
Right. Bertha Barbie McNeil, the old school Velvets. She helped to foster even more commitment to music and understanding it and really learning it. And then my high school teacher, Mrs. Kerstetter, my high school choir teacher, very involved in Kalamazoo.
Are you talking about Marie Kerstetter?
Oh, yes.
We love Marie.
You know, she was the, that was when I first heard of a musical. I'd never heard of a musical until I was in high school. I mean, like, wow. A real musical. Everybody was like, haven't you seen Oklahoma? And I was like, hmm? You know, I had no idea what they were talking about.
You're like, no, I've never been to that state. What's the topic about Oklahoma?
I've never been. I know it's, yeah, that's what I can tell you. I don't really know what you're asking. So just growing up and grabbing any opportunity that would come my way, you know, that it was drama club and forensics. I just took any opportunity to perform, literally.
Oh,
any.
Really?
I did forensics. Yep. We were not looking at each other. I still couldn't tell you what forensics is. I have no idea.
Wait. What was your, sounds like multiple or duo? Okay. Our producer tonight, who's also my son, Jason Koch, he competes in forensics. He actually won a state championship his freshman year in storytelling 9-10.
Woo!
Shout out to my boy.
I still, like, if you ask me, define forensics, I'd be like, I don't know. I just know we did really weird stuff and we didn't look at each other. We got really goofy and didn't look at each other. And we memorized some version of lines. That's all I know. I don't know. But yeah, so... what's funny is when I started at Western, I was an undeclared major. I was like, well, I'm an honor student, so I guess I got to take smart classes. Just no direction, right? I knew I needed some, what people told me was my backup plan. So I took Spanish and the honors classes that were available to me. And then 2 years in, I was like, no, I really want to perform. Like, I just want to try this. So I auditioned for the musical theater program and I got in and I was like,
oh, what high school is it? What high school is this?
I went to high school at Lloyd Norrix, but then I went to Western Michigan. So I auditioned for that musical theater program. I had heard, oh, it's so hard to get in. And I just thought, oh, I'm not going to get in. You know, I'm not that great with musicals. I don't know what I'm doing. And then that was kind of the start
of
looking at my profession and like deciding this is what I want to do.
Talent is talent.
I guess
they saw your talent. You walked in, they saw your talent and they were like, come on in.
You know, I remember at that audition too. I like flubbed a lyric or something and I was like, no, keep going. Da, 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 you know, and I think that was just like, okay, she got some spunk. Okay, cool.
Yep.
You know, we'll let her in. We'll see what she does.
You can tell a lot from people. I mean, now that I've been on both sides of the table, you know, as an actor auditioning, but as a producer auditioning actors, you can learn a lot about someone from how they respond to mistakes or, you know, unintended, you know, occurrences. You got to keep going. You got to keep rolling with the punches for sure.
Just smile and walk it off.
That's right.
Keep rolling.
I bet you have some, I don't want to get ahead of myself, but I wonder if you have some like fun audition stories from your time in LA.
Oh God. I don't know if I could remember an audition that I just really comically blew, but what's funnier is that in LA, and this was kind of like the hard lesson that I learned, was there's a little bit of like everybody thinks they're amazing. Like there's so much ego in LA. I would go to these auditions and they would talk it up so much. You know, you got to sign the NDA and do all this stuff. And then I'd look at their script and I'd be like, this is terrible.
Egos. Wait a minute. Are you sure there's big egos in LA? That's just... I'm not sure.
The funnier thing, not my auditions, the funnier thing is the things that I've actually worked, like booked and worked. I did a stop motion green screen surfer girl short film. And when I tell you the budget was real low, it is so bad. I tried to find it one day to like make fun of myself, like to laugh at, because I remember when I watched it the first time, I can't find it. And I'm hoping one day, I only want to get famous so that somebody digs that up and says, this is you, you know, X years ago. That's like, that's when I feel like I'll reach the pinnacle of my career.
Sometimes those things, they can be the most fun or the most memorable, or I don't know, for some reason I'm thinking about one of my favorite movies that's so bad that it's good, Grease 2, and Michelle Pfeiffer I think is really good in that movie. You know what I mean? And it's like,
it may not be your cup of tea to watch on a Friday night, but there's some talent is talent. Talent is talent.
That's right.
I will say that talent don't always show up even if you got it. So.
I want to see your stop motion movie. Jason, try to track that down, would you?
Somebody find it. It's so bad. It's so bad.
I really want to see it now. Now it's like everyone's probably Googling this right now.
Cassandra Blair.
Like Cassandra Blair, Surfer Girl.
If you do, please tell me. I've looked.
So is it listed on your IMDb credits or no?
I auditioned in the public library. We weren't even in a private room. It was at a table.
Wait, where was this? Where was it? Where was this? Just
in LA. Sorry, I'm fixing my nursing bra because my son just left.
Well, we were gonna we're gonna talk about that too. Yeah. You know, being like such a great performer, and now as a mom, you know, and that probably adds such a level to your acting and your singing, and obviously having a kid changes your life for the better.
That was hi, Brian.
Hey, Ponzi. The good old days of the civic Little Shop of Horrors.
Yes, I do remember that. I remember that very well. Man, there's so many memories from shows in Kalamazoo. Yes. The getting pregnant, honestly, that's when I started booking. That's when I really started booking.
Really?
Because, you know, when you come into the audition room, you bring your energy, and your energy is some of your natural essence. It's nerves, it's what you're expecting, what you're, you know, afraid of, whatever. Yep. And when I got pregnant, my whole priority shifted. First of all, I didn't feel like going to the audition. They were letting me show up. You know, I was like, you look, I got to get my hair and makeup on and get dressed and come to you. Oh Lord, you know? So it was no longer like, I didn't have that pressure to book that job or to impress these people or do what they like. That really kind of, I mean, I was working on not doing that anyway, but it really, really faded with the, you know, addition of something so much more important in my life. And so removing all of that pressure and just coming in like, look, this is kind of what you get. This is what I'm going to bring. And if you like it, cool, let's roll. If not, I'll see you another time. That energy shift was what I was really booking. And especially after I had Jonathan, I couldn't believe how much I was booking. You know, I went from booking like nothing to not only booking, but increasing in, you know, things, not just like my short films and these indie things, but then I was actually getting these co-stars and getting on network TV. You know, I booked Westworld. I was 7.5 months pregnant. I shot it at 2 weeks before I had the baby.
What?
Yeah.
Wait, were they looking for someone that was real pregnant?
Nope. They sure weren't.
What?
I have an amazing manager. Maritza Cabrera, she's absolutely incredible and she's such a hustler. And she signed me on when I was very pregnant. I was like, Maritza, you gonna take on a pregnant woman? Like, I'm not gonna book anything for a while. She was like, you're fine. Let me do my job. And sure enough, like 2 weeks later, I got the audition and it didn't say anything about pregnant. It was just, you know, this random small role in the show. And I showed up full belly, you know, read the line and I booked it. And she's like, I think they liked that. You know, you being pregnant just added this like authenticity to it, you know? And I was like, okay.
So you didn't try to hide it.
I sure didn't. I was like, at that point there was no hiding. I could hide it for a very long time. It's amazing how long you can hide it if you work at it. So I was working up to 6.5 months pregnant and the jobs that I booked, they didn't know. Except for there was one that we were supposed to shoot, you know, in like a week, and then it got delayed and I got a little bigger and the wardrobe people were like, did you? Is that? And I was like, mm-hmm. And they were like, that's okay. I won't say anything. We'll get you some stretchy pants. Okay, good. Do you need a chair? And also I don't pee. I just always end my entire cut. Not peeing.
Yes. Oh my gosh. That's amazing. It's amazing that you were able to do that. And, you know, it is such a lesson that some of us don't learn. I didn't learn it until I was out of New York. But, you know, a lot of young actors, they go in and they just try to give the people behind the table what they think they want.
Yes.
You know, and there's a little bit of desperation there just because you want to book that gig. And then when you throw all that away, when you're just like, I'm going to do my thing. And if I book it, cool. And if not, that's cool. There's something really attractive about that as a producer when someone's just sort of like, hey, what's up?
Absolutely. Like when you come in with the energy of, I need this, that's what you give. that's what you give. And they don't want somebody that needs this, because then you're not there living in the work. You're there yeah. to get the job and to get the paycheck yes. and to pay your rent. And that's not being present in the work. And that comes out. It's amazing how much you learn about what your energy brings to your audition. And when you cut that out, you know, I remember hearing kind of like you're doing, like interviewing people who have kind of furthered themselves in their career. And there was somebody who was a vet, an acting vet. And they said, you know, when I really started working is when I just stopped doing what I thought they were looking for and just yep. brought me. When you bring you, that's the special sauce. That's the good stuff. Like, it's nobody else can be you, right? So right. bringing you is the best thing that you can do. So and true. I kept, you know, reminding myself of that. And then finally it came through.
This is good advice to any young actors out there.
Sure, for sure.
Getting some good advice. Well, our producer, Jason, put up some pictures earlier. The first one is sort of a collage that I made of headshots, you pregnant with Jonathan, and a couple screenshots from some of your movies or TV or TV work. I want to go back though to either Western, if you have any stories about your time at Western or at the Kalamazoo Civic, or if not, like just Jason also showed a collage of pictures from our production of Vanya and Sonia.
That was so much fun. I hadn't done a stage play in a few years, and David Alpert, who directed that, you know, he was a longtime friend of mine. We met in my first year of the musical theater program at Western because he directed as a student directed play and or musical rather, excuse me. And he was like, he emailed me and was like, I think you probably be really good at this. Do you want to read for this? And I was like, sure. You know, I guess, that's fine. So I was like, I haven't done stage in a while. You know, it's a different medium. You know, it really requires a different skill set. And I was like, I'm kind of rusty. And so I submitted a tape and he was like, yeah, you know what? You can be bigger. That was kind of like the general note, like be a little bit bigger, be a little more specific. You know, that's common. And so I did another take and I ended up booking it and I came in. And when we started putting the show on its feet, boy, did it get big. I mean, I was like, oh, wow. Yeah, I wasn't big enough. There was so much room to just like live in this character's crazy. And it was so much fun. And we had such a good cast. It was so easy to have fun. I was having such a hard time not laughing. I don't know if you remember that. I did a horrible job of not laughing.
Well, it's Christopher Durang, who is a very funny playwright. David Alpert handled it really well as the director. Yeah. You're hysterical. We had some veterans like Wendy Clarendon and John Schumann and Elizabeth Terrell and Kate Thompson. And then Nathan Cockcroft, who's a newcomer, but is also super talented. So yeah, killer cast, great script. I cracked up, but I'm allowed. You had to.
No, you were allowed. That was definitely not my job.
Was it weird to play a part called Cassandra? Have you ever done that before?
No, I think it actually made it maybe like a little more fun because it was like. Like I said, I was born a little bit dramatic. That was natural. And it kind of gave me permission to be even more myself. You know, it was like, yeah. Oh, she's called Cassandra. I also happen to be called Cassandra. Yeah, let's do this. Let's yes. just smile out. You know, I can just be my crazy self.
Yes.
And share the name with her and live her life with permission.
Well, and as you can see, viewers, there was a scene where there's like a costume party and they dress up like Snow White and one of the dwarfs. And then in the top right corner, you can see that Cassandra was not holding anything back, throwing herself into this role totally.
Oh, man, I was jumping on tables and swatting at people with spatulas. It was so much fun.
Was it a little, is it daunting? Because I think, you know, probably with Durang and with David Alpert as director, the reins were probably off. He probably, within reason, allowed you to do just about whatever you wanted. Is that freeing, or is it a little scary to be like, I can do whatever I want?
I think a little of both. I think it's scary because it takes off the parameters. You know, it's like when you go into a store and they give you too many options and then you're like, I need you to limit this down for me. So it's scary because you want to make sure you're staying within the right box. But then it also is like, I'm just going to try everything. And you tell me if it's the wrong box. And that would happen in rehearsal. They would be like, try something else. I'd be like, okay. And I would try something totally different. It'd be like, wrong box. Wrong selection.
Mm-hmm. Okay, check that one out. You're like taking...
Cool. Got it.
Cross that off. Yep.
So try a different one. So another one. Okay, got it.
So you know, fun.
They let you know.
But that's what, you know what I mean? That's kind of what most of us, you know, love about the theater, how we got into it in the first place. Like you said, you're kind of ham in the spotlight. I was the same way. You know, just this idea of just like playing and just, you know, using your imagination and just doing the storytelling to, you know, to on a different level. Yeah. I mean, that's just got to be.
Right? Yeah. That's what I love so much is I could captivate somebody and not just for the attention. You know, a lot of people think that you get into performing because you like attention. No, I like having an effect on you. Like seeing how what I do affects you is really cool. It can be really rewarding. It can be, you know, it can be validating in some circumstances, but it can also be challenging to see how do I deliver this story in a way that you will receive it and what are you receiving out of it? That's the magical part to me is the effect that the reciprocation, you know, between you and the person watching. That's
totally agree. And there's nothing like it, right? I mean, TV and film acting is great, but there's nothing like having that live audience right there in front of you.
Oh my goodness. Instant gratification.
Electric.
I did a show and bless his heart, one of my best friends. I did a play in LA. And there was this part where me and this other girl, you know, there's like a little bit of tension, you know, and I'm in the show, I'm in a relationship, I'm in a committed relationship. And then this moment of sexual tension happens and it's like, oh, did they just do what I think they did? And out loud, my friend goes, oh, and it was a small, like, you know, I don't know, 70 person theater. There, everybody heard him, and the whole audience like pauses, starts cracking up laughing. Her and I break. We can't help it. We start cracking up laughing, and we felt so bad because we totally broke character. But at the end of the day, it was like that's theater. This had an effect on him. You know what I mean?
Yep.
Had a visceral effect on him. He's like, ooh! You know. It was so funny. It was so it's funny,
hysterical.
And it's like,
well, that's what we do. You know, we audiences laugh or cry or clap. Sometimes they gasp. So, you know, that was a different kind of gasp, but it's valid. That's
with still a reaction.
You brought it out of it.
And in that moment, you know, yep. And that was telling of us telling the story. It was like, he believed it. He was involved. He was, you know, invested.
He was invested.
And that was cool. That's a win to me.
So tell me about how you made the decision to move to LA, you know, so you've done all the stage work, you got your, you know, your degree in theater. How did you come to move to LA?
The funny thing is I never graduated. So I did like 4.5 years, and it was because long story short, I joined the program late and I needed all these prereqs in order to graduate with that specific degree. And when I met with my counselor, she was like, yeah, you actually need to do like 2 or 3 more years. And I said,
Is it a sit with
them? No, we're not doing that. So I was like, okay, no. And then it was like, okay, well, where do I go? Do I go to New York, Chicago, LA, whatever? And everybody was like, if you want to do theater, you got to go to New York. And I really, really wanted to sing. That was my first real love. I love to sing. I love music. And I was convinced. You couldn't tell me that I wasn't going to be the next Beyonce. I mean, you just could not tell me. And so I was like, LA it is. Here I come. Yep. And then I got there and I was like, oh, I'm not even close to Beyonce. This is not going to work. so, you know, branching out, I was like, well, I still love acting and performing and entertaining in that way. So what do I do? And I took this commercial class with this guy, Bobby Jean. He introduced me to just any version of camera work. I'd never had it before. Yeah. And he also was just like a really great mentor and kind of held my hand a little bit through the experience. And then I said, this is really cool. And I started taking like acting on camera classes and being like, oh, this is really cool because it was what I had done before, but even more intimate and even more like really dialed in. And I loved working on that. I was still, you know, I came from this broad acting and, you know, you got to get everybody in this whole theater to see what you're doing and understand to now this camera's, you know, here. You ain't got to do a lot. That challenge was really, really cool for me. And I really enjoyed. And then I started watching movies differently and seeing such nuance. You know, my husband had me watch The Heat of the Night with Sidney Poitier, and watching him, I was like, this guy, he did this scene in the jail cell with this prisoner, and he did nothing for like 5-10 minutes, but he was there, and I said, wow, okay, this is really cool. So I just, you know, I went to pursue singing. That kind of just didn't pan out. I realized I don't really know what I'm doing. I just love to sing, but I don't know how to be an artist. Let's call space babe. So I just started looking at other things because I knew I still wanted to deliver art. That's what I wanted to do. I wanted to express myself through art. Found my way into TV and film.
Yeah. Yep. Well, we actually have a clip. So you know, after a while of, you know, doing the grind and going to all those auditions, I think you said there was one commercial that you booked that had maybe more of an impact than the others.
Yeah, definitely. So this was the one I booked when I was, I think I had just found out that I was pregnant when I booked this, and I shot it, and I was about 3 months pregnant. and this was for Ulta. And what was really funny, you know, and this isn't me like being self-deprecating or like wanting a compliment at all, but it's Ulta, it's a beauty commercial. They hire models. Now, I know I'm naturally beautiful, but I was like, I'm not in the model category. I'm the, like, you know, she's attractive, she's unique, whatever. But in terms of casting, they don't put me in model. Okay. I'm a little bit more normal, especially when you take away all the red lipstick and, you know, so I was like, Ulta. And so I went in there like, okay, let me just get this audition over with real quick. And I booked it. And then I ended up being like the last frame in the commercial, like it closes on the logo over my face. And I did, when we were shooting, oh my God, I felt like this is my dream come true. They had me in, it was a bridge over the LA River, which, if you know LA, the LA River is not really a river. It's just a place where water collects when we have our rainy season. So it becomes a river 3-4 times a year. It's just this dry thing. Hundreds and hundreds, probably thousands of things are shot on the, you know, with the LA River in the background. So we're on the LA, over the LA River. They've closed off a whole lane. They've got cops and like motorcycle cops. And I was like, they're doing all this for this one little shot. Okay, cool. And they, you know, they were very specific about my makeup. I mean, I've never gone in for a makeup test for a commercial. I've shot, I don't know, a dozen commercials, never did a makeup test. They were very specific about everything. So the director comes up and she's like, okay, we're going to have you just walk and then turn back to me. And in my head, I'm like, I'm about to do a walk and turn. Oh my God. So I do it. I'm like, okay, got it. So I walk and then I turn over my shoulder and I was like, this is what models do. Oh my God.
See, you are a model after all.
I was living my best life, Jeremy, shooting that commercial. And we did it like, I don't know, 20 times. And I just would look over my shoulder. She'd be like, now strong, you know, nobody can beat you. It was like, you're a cat.
You're a cat.
It was amazing.
Did they
was
so really say fun. That? They really said you're a cat.
It was so much fun. And then I saw it and I was like, oh, babe! You know, with my husband, they used my shot. They closed on my shot. How cool is that? And it paid really well. So Bobby Jean, you know, that commercial teacher, he wasn't wrong. He was like, if you want to pay your rent, book a commercial. That paid my LA rent.
That's right. I think we gotta see this. I think we gotta see this. Jason, please roll the Ulta commercial. Oh, she don't see the light that's shining deeper than the eyes can find it. Maybe we are made of blind souls. She tries to cover up her pain and cut her woes away. Cause cover girls don't cry after the face is made. There's a hope that's waiting for you in the dark. No scars, see you beautiful. With stars, we're beautiful. I'm telling you, over the shoulder look is gold. Did I get it? Did I get the part?
You nailed it.
That's that's awesome. I remember seeing that and saying to my wife, to Deneen, that's Cassandra. And then I think
a gynecologist recognized me. It was so bizarre. He was like, did I just see you in a commercial? And I was like, really? You recognize me from that? It was pretty cool.
I mean, in addition to your beautiful face and these great red lips, you've got this amazing hair. How much do you think your hair helps you book gigs?
100%.
Okay.
100%.
Okay.
That was something that, and this is when you talk about like inclusion and diversity being a part of the conversation now in a way that it didn't used to be.
Yeah.
When I first came out, people first started seeing natural curly hair and, you know, more people of color, particularly women, as kind of the, not necessarily the ingenue, but this person that you want to draw attention to. And mm-hmm. So people, I would, you know, go to auditions and stuff and meet with agents and they'd say, yeah, your look is really in right now. And the funny thing is that it was cool for me because I thought, well, great, I'll have more opportunities now. Mm-hmm. And then that's turned into kind of an insidious part of conversations about the industry and diversity, because now people are saying, well, you know, the ethnic look is what's in. And so it implies that there's less work for white people, or the, you know, the norm that we have been accustomed to seeing. And so we have to continue to educate ourselves and each other that it's not taking away from, you know, that work. The work is there. It's accessible to everybody.
Yeah.
We're just giving people a platform that didn't have it before. They're giving people a voice and we're getting eyes on that they weren't there before.
Yeah. Do you think there's also the sense of, you know, different is in, where it gives this idea that, I mean, you're not different. You know what I mean? You are America. You know, someone who looks like you is what America looks like.
I have so many stories, Jeremy, especially when I first started wearing my hair natural. I didn't even know what my natural hair looked like until I was about 19. I had no idea, because I was perming and relaxing my hair. We say perm, it means relax, like straightening, sure. Since I was, you know, 5-6 years old.
Wow.
I didn't know it did this. I had no idea. And when I first started wearing my hair natural, I worked at, it's no longer there anymore, they closed, but I worked at Perkins. I was a waitress at Perkins. Do you remember Perkins over on Sprinkle Road?
Vaguely.
Across from Denny's off
yeah. Okay.
So, and I would work third shift while I was going to school. Okay. I still had bills to pay and, you know, and there was this couple that would come in, this older white couple, they'd come in every day, like as soon as morning hit, it was like 5:30, they'd come in and I'd bring them their coffee and they'd order like, you know, their pancakes and oatmeal or whatever. And one day they came in and I had my hair, it was, and they let me wear my hair like out at this Perkins. We weren't following the health codes. I think my hair was supposed to be tied back, but my manager was like, it's fine. And so I came and my hair was all big. And at the time, this was like October area or November, I had this big hair. And I said, hey guys, how you doing this morning? I'm finishing my shift. Do you want your coffee? And they said, huh, you look different. Talking about different, right? You look different. And I said, yeah, this is my natural hair. This is kind of just how it is when I don't do anything to it. And they were like, huh. I mean, they were perplexed. Huh. They said, was it for Halloween? I said, no, this is just my hair. And I kid you not, Jeremy. They said, it looks like you stuck your finger in a light socket. I went, you know what? I'm gonna go get Doris. You're gonna get your coffee. And I had to just tap out. I was like, I can't. So that feeling of I'm a circus animal, you know, like, yeah, no, it shouldn't be that I'm so unique and I'm so different. It should just be that I'm a person.
Right.
And you should see more of me so that I'm not weird to you. And so the fact that we are including people who look like me more is amazing. It also comes with these other things that people are, like you said, like, oh, they're so unique, they're so different. That's a part of it, but it's kind of the growing pains. It's like, you have to realize that I'm not that different, but you're not going to know until you see me. You're not going to know until you see us. So we got to start somewhere, right?
Right. Right. And then it snowballs. The more we have that inclusivity and that diversity, and it just becomes the norm, then we finally will get to the point where we just say, this is what American people look like, they look like all different kinds of people, right?
Absolutely.
We're all unique.
Koch Korner was so incredible. You know, watching these little black boys point at this poster and look like, I can be that. I'm going to play a superhero. And so we'll get to a point where we'll stop saying, I'm going to play a black superhero. I'm just going to play a superhero. Not to take away, you know, not to imply that there's colorblindness, because that's another thing that's not great. That's another conversation. But the idea that I can be a superhero, and that everybody can go, anybody can be a superhero. An Asian can be, a Hispanic can be, a black person, so on and so forth. Like, we just need to see it. We need to see it to believe that that's possible, and to become comfortable with that in our daily lives, so that our brains now recognize that as safe. Because when you're not familiar with it, it becomes unsafe. And then our defense mechanisms come up, and that's where fear and violence come from. So we got
to. And that's why I feel like theater and the arts helps to break those fears and those, you know, the ignorance of those belief systems. It helps break them down. Because when you go to the theater, especially if you're in a play, but even just watching, you know, you're usually putting yourself in someone else's shoes. You're trying to relate to someone in that story. That's, you know, and so the more that's what creates empathetic people, and empathy will eliminate hatred and fear and ignorance.
Absolutely.
Eventually.
Absolutely. It can definitely, it, that empathy that you tap into in the arts is the trigger for some real change within ourselves. It's really an opportunity to reflect on, ooh, I had no idea what that person was going through until I saw it more deeply, more close up, more intimately. When I was really let into their lives and almost feel like a part of it, boy, that can make some real change. I've seen it. I've felt it myself about things that I had, you know, biases about, and I've seen my family experience it too. Like, oh man, now that I've seen it, like now that I've really seen it.
And it can change the whole, you know, consciousness of the public. I feel like the more arts, where TV, film, theater, dance, symphonic, you know, all of that can help shape the consciousness of the country and move the needle to where we have more of the tolerance and the acceptance and the diversity.
Absolutely.
So the arts, you know what I mean? The arts can really do that. And we've seen it happen.
Absolutely. We are doing it.
Yes. Mm-hmm. Yes. And we'll continue to do so. Tell me, let's talk about moms. We have this upcoming event called Songs in the Key of Mom. It's a Farmer's Alley virtual concert featuring seven amazing women singing songs either about motherhood. Some of them are moms. Some of them are singing to their moms. So if you loved our Valentine's Day event, it's very similar to that, except with seven amazing women this time. So tell us a little bit about your mom. Tell us about being a mom, and tell us about the song you're singing.
Oh yeah, man. My mom, there's one thing I learned from my mom. It's resilience and strength. You know, when you talk about a single mother who had to thug it out and grind it out and hustle to provide for two kids. I mean, that's my mom through and through. I've seen her go through so much and still come out and be like, all right, well, you got to keep going, you know? And it's like, wow, how do you have that kind of strength to push through? And I watched my mom do that my whole life. And I was like, okay, I would think like, if my mom can do it, I can do it. You know, I've seen my mom do it, so I can do it.
Yep.
And she kind of pushed me to have that. Like, you just got to wipe your knees off, get dust it off and get up and keep going. And so that is really where I got my resilience and my strength from, was watching my mother. And then becoming a mom myself, boy, it was like somebody wrapped a whole bunch of just bricks. Was like, you know, I was like, oh my goodness, I wasn't ready. I thought this was going to be easy. You know, like I thought I was totally, you know, rehearsed for this. It was like a rehearsal. I've rehearsed.
Right.
I know all my lines. I'm ready.
I'm ready. And it's opening night, and here's a baby.
It's opening night. Here's the baby. And oh my gosh, what is happening? You know, there's this. I also, since becoming a mom, there's not, in addition to social activism for diversity and inclusion and equity, it also made me realize how much women, in that same vein, in equity, how much women are not educated about our bodies and about pregnancy and about childbirth and being a new mom. And there's a huge lack of support in our system for that. So I was feeling it. It really hit me. But I also was filled with a love for this human that was unmatched by anything ever in my life. And it was like, I was like, nobody can touch him. I'm the only one that can, he's only safe with me. You know, I felt like Smeagol in the Lord of the Rings. My precious. You know, my precious. Man, I was a different animal. But yeah. Since then, I've become a little more normal. Somebody took the ring off, and I got my sanity back. But it's incredible, this change that you go through, this metamorphosis and evolution that you go through as a woman. And it's there's also that too for fathers, but it's very, very unique for women, because your body is the one going through it, and sure. You have birthed this person. Literally. This human,
literally,
it's amazing, and yeah. what a difference that made in my sense of self and my perception of the world and other people, and just, you know, it increased my empathy tenfold. I already felt like I was a pretty empathetic person to begin with, but boy, I was like, oh man, especially to other mothers, it was like, who am I to judge? You know what? Do you? However you get through your day, girl, you do you. Because this is hard. If you're still standing at the end of the day, congratulations.
There was a quote, my friend Julie Nemitz, who's a part of Farmers Alley and who directed and created this event that we did a couple of years ago called Does Anybody Have a Map Stories about Motherhood? Mm-hmm. And one of the quotes that she found online was, I used to think moms with wet hair were lazy, but now I know they were just showing off. In other words, yeah, they actually had time to take a shower.
Can I tell you how many days I went without a shower? That first year was rough. It was so rough. I barely showered. I mean, and then washing hair, please. This hair? Please. That's all I got to say. I remember one time, I mean, I just broke down because I was like, you know what? This is what, you know, I'm going to wash my hair. Today I'm going to wash my hair. Today's the day. And I tell you, I read a meme once. I was like, you know, name something. I'm terrible at repeating memes. It's like, you should have been there. But it was something like, name an Olympic event that isn't, you know, that isn't an Olympic event. And somebody was like, a natural hair wash day, meaning like washing this. It's a full day. So I got like through steps 1 through 3. And I had a head full of conditioner and it was sopping and dripping. And I was like, pulling my curls because you got to like detangle it and stuff. It was such a mess. Oh, no. And Jonathan woke up, scream crying. I went, I can't do this. It's like, first of all, first world problems. Girl, calm down. It's fine. Just take your conditioned hair and go get your baby.
That's but, right.
Yeah, the girl with wet hair is showing off. Good for you. You got to shower.
Does your husband help out?
So much. So much. He wants to be and is super dad. He is so involved. You know, he took so much time off in the beginning just because he wanted to be there. He wanted to embrace every little part in the swaddling and the poop and the spitting up and the, you know, the padding, everything.
Feeding and the walking.
Everything. He was, you know, when I had to nurse Jonathan, he was like, when's my turn? You know, like he was to be a part of it. He so loves caring for this baby and helping to form this loved, happy child. And like every time they go out, he's got this like huge backpack, the baby backpack. And he goes, you want to go on an adventure with dad? You want to go on an adventure with daddy? And then he's got a carrier for the bike. They just go and do fun stuff. And he could not be happier. He's love so it. Amazing. I love it. The jackpot there.
Well, speaking of super dad, that's kind of a nice segue into your song. Tell us a little bit about your song that you're singing for our Mother's Day.
Yeah. I picked Superwoman by Alicia Keys. And it's, you know, Alicia Keys, first of all, is just a gem. You know, if you watch not only her work as an artist, but her energy, her spirit is just so beautiful. She radiates so much. Talk about warmth. Boy, that's a warm energy and a beautiful energy. And so I love pretty much everything that she does. She can do no wrong, if you ask me. She's pretty awesome.
Yeah.
And the song, it's not even one of her like most popular ones, but it's so affirming to say, you know what, I'm amazing. With everything that I do and everything that I overcome, I'm freaking amazing. And there's something really special about declaring that to yourself and to say it to another woman. You know, there's I see a lot of these images of like inspirational quotes, and it's like, let's start fixing our sisters' crowns instead of making fun of them for being crooked, like empowering and saying, you're also amazing. You go, girl. That's really special when we can, you know, uplift ourselves and edify ourselves and affirm ourselves, and also be so comfortable with that, that we can love on somebody else and not cut them down. I don't need you to be down for me to be up. Let's both be up.
I love it. Mm-hmm. I love that. We could just end right there, but we can't, because we got to show our viewers a little bit of your amazing song with your amazing voice and your beautiful face. Jason, please show Cassandra's song. I just love that. I love that line. Even when I'm a mess, I still put on a vest with an S on my chest. You know, it just, and I'm not a mom, but I am a dad, a two-time dad. Yeah. So I know a little bit about what that's like, but yeah, you're absolutely right. There's nothing wrong with saying, you know, I'm doing this. I'm juggling this. This is hard, but I'm doing it. I feel like a super person, a super woman. And I love the idea of looking out for your fellow moms, your sisters, and, you know, helping them instead of tearing them down. Put that on a big sign and like, let's plaster across the sky. Preston, declare to yourself, I'm amazing. That is advice we all need. Yes. Thank you for watching, Preston. And you're absolutely right. We need to build ourselves up. There's a lot of, you know, fear and negativity right now for many reasons. And so the more we can spread that, like I said, watching you sing that just, it really filled me with so much love and hope and joy.
I'm so glad. And you're right. Like you gotta be full before you can share with other people. You know, your ship has to be afloat. You have to be comfortable with you, because you can't really love on other people when you're feeling less than, and when you're feeling insecure, and when you're feeling not enough. So when you feel enough, that gives you permission to build up everybody else around you. That's how we get better.
It is. Mm-hmm. And that's how we fix so many problems. Mm-hmm. So many problems.
It really does.
Starting here, spreading that out to your inner circle. You know, I feel sometimes like I want to solve all the world's problems, you know, the countries or the states, you know what I mean? But we have to do that famous cliche of, you know, thinking globally but acting locally, you know?
Yeah.
And, you know, raising our kids to be the kind of people that we would want them to be, you know what I mean? Knowing that they're going to be the next generation of problem solvers and
cures
and fixers and joy bringers.
Yeah, that was another thing that I started really changing how I thought, what kind of parent I thought I was going to be. You know, I had this image of what kind of parent and how I was going to mother my child. And a lot of it came from how I was raised, and then realizing like, oh, you know what? The most important thing to me is that this child is self-confident and secure and safe to explore. And I'm like, if they have those things, the rest is window dressing.
You know what I mean? Plus they're going to love the arts. They're going to be empathetic. Yeah. You know, and we need that empathy. We need oodles of it.
Yeah.
Especially going forward into the next, you know, couple of years, next generations, oodles. Right?
Oodles. My son watches Word Party, and Lulu loves oodles and oodles of noodles. When you watch Word Party. That's the first thing I thought of when you said oodles.
I'm gonna have to check that out. It's been a while.
you got grown kids.
My kids are a little older, so we're not really. We used to watch Backyardigans and Wonder Pets. I love them. They're great.
Yeah, man. I get into it. I'll be up there watching with them. I'll be like, what's she going to do? Are they going to eat noodles or rice? I don't know. Let's see.
And then Jonathan's like, he's trying to like do something else. Like, let's go outside. You're like, hold on. I got to see how this.
Hold on. Wait. We got to find out what happened. Did I go outside? Or, what's she going to do with her giraffe? Are they gonna fix it? I really need to know, baby. I need to know. Just wait.
I gotta check out these noodles. Just hang on.
I know.
Well, Your song, Superwoman, is one of seven for the Farmer's Alley event, Songs in the Key of Mom. It's a Farmer's Alley virtual concert celebrating moms and people who are moms and people who have moms. And you can get your tickets soon at farmersalleytheater.com. And you're definitely going to want to do that and see the entire song. If you like that clip, and I know you did, you're going to want to hear Cassandra sing that entire song. Other singers we're featuring include my wife, Deneen Mulay-Koch, and Whitney Weiner, and Jasmine Franklin, and Michelle Micah Berg. It's going to be just a fantastic group of people. And Julie Nevitz is singing as well. And it's sponsored by Waddell's Nursery, Florist, and Garden Center. So there you go.
Get mama some flowers too.
Get mama some flowers from Waddell's. That's right.
I love a good bouquet. Yeah.
Who doesn't?
My husband's always like, you know, I like to get you practical gifts. I'm like, you could also just give me flowers.
That really works.
Flowers.
Brightens up a room. Well, listen, I need to wrap up here. We are at that time. I want to thank you so much for being here. Like I said, your energy and your strength and your positivity is just infectious. And I love talking to you, and I love that you're featured in this event, and I want to do more collaborations with you in the future.
I'm honored and touched and so happy to be a part of you spreading joy and inclusion and diversity and all of these good things and all of your efforts. You know, I've been watching what you and Farmers Alley have been doing in Michigan. It's just wonderful. It's lovely. I'm excited for you guys.
Thank you so much. Yeah. It means a lot. It really does.
Yeah.
How can my viewers follow you?
I'm on Instagram. Although I'll tell you, you'll see that I became a mom because you'll see when those posts stop coming. But I am, at some point I'll enter the real life again. The pandemic really hit that shoe. But I am on Instagram as Cassandra Blair Curly Hair. Yes, I was really proud of that handle. So you can give me kudos if you want.
I like it. I like it a lot. It's long, but once you follow her, you don't need to ever type it again. You just follow her.
It's so clever.
It is very clever. Well, and it's true. Your hair is amazing. Let's see. What else? Is there anything, any final words, any final thoughts?
Oh, man. You know, it's just this, you said it in the beginning. These are tough times. These are tough times. So whenever you have time to find empathy and find joy, I think that's how we climb out of darkness, finding empathy and finding joy. And that's what you guys are doing, which is really incredible. But find it wherever you can. Go get Thank it wherever you, you can. Because once you have it, it's a lot easier to move forward with that good attitude.
Amen.
Yeah, amen.
Thank you so much. Those are really good words to live by and to hear right now. And I hope everyone enjoyed watching you and listening to you as much as I did.
I think I'm hilarious. You can say I laugh at myself a lot.
I've been known to laugh at my own jokes. Our producer can attest to that. Jason Koch, right. Who turns 18 tomorrow. Jason, why don't you come and say hi real quick?
Hey, yes. Hey. Crazy. Hi, Cassandra.
Happy birthday, ready? Happy birthday.
Yeah.
Happy birthday. Happy birthday. Okay, well,
you
know what? We're going to
say
that for another.
No, that was perfect. That was perfect.
We're putting that on YouTube. Let's go to YouTube.
I heard a little riff, Jason. I heard you riff. Go ahead, boy.
Thank you. I can certainly attest to my dad thinking he's hilarious with his dad. I mean, we say they're dumb, but we do love them. We secretly love them.
My mom's good for a really good corny joke. Man.
I try not to egg him on, but yes. I'll give him that. I will give him that.
It's gonna continue, though. It's gonna get worse as they age.
It's a cliche for a reason. Dad jokes are here to stay.
Man, I love them. Thank you guys so much for having
me. Thanks again, Cassandra. I'm going to do a little wrap up here. Thank you for being with us. Much love to you and your family. Jason, thank you for being the producer and for joining us there a minute. Happy birthday tomorrow, my son. Cassandra, have a wonderful night. Thank you again for being here. Much love to you.
Thank you for all of your work.
Thank you. Thank you. Up next at Farmers Alley Theater. We are on Sunday, April 25th at 8 p.m. Host Adam Weiner will host a Broadway Battle Trivia Edition. Again, that's right. This time there will be right and wrong answers for our contestants, and they are not just at the whim of the all-powerful host. It should be filled with jazz hands, high notes, and lots of fun. Roger Burley returns as a champion, defend his championship, and Ken Holden and Chris Alamang will try to dethrone him. Join us this Sunday, April 25th at 8 p.m. for Broadway Battles Trivia Edition. A quick appeal. This pandemic has hit lots of people and lots of industries and lots of businesses really hard. The arts industry has been hit especially hard. If you like what we do and you're financially able to, please consider making a donation. You can give to us at farmersalleytheater.online/give or text the word give to 269-230-0001. And again, thanks so much for watching. Please go to farmersalleytheater.com to get your tickets to Songs in the Key of Mom, Mother's Day virtual event concert celebration. Thanks again for watching. And in the spirit of creating art and theater, which is always collaborative, let's remember we have to work together to make the world a better place. Good night, everybody.